No. 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 Yes.
Daddy, listen.
Live from the forest moon of Endor, Radio Free Endor, Star Wars Podcast, bringing you news and reviews from the galaxy far, far away.
Welcome to the special showcase on Radio Free Endor. Today, it is my pleasure to introduce a talented artist who has captured the imaginations of Star Wars fans all over the galaxy. He's the creative force behind some of the most iconic, stunning, detailed Star Wars artwork you've probably ever seen. From epic space battles to intimate character portraits, Sam's art captures the essence of what makes Star Wars such a beloved and enduring franchise. With a keen eye for detail and a deep love for the Star Wars universe, Sam's work is nothing short of breathtaking. Whether you're a diehard fan of the original trilogy or a new fan of the more recent films and TV shows, Sam's art is sure to transport you to a galaxy far, far away. Please join me in welcoming one and only Sam Gilbey. You're okay, Sam?
Hello. Well, after that, I think I need to go and have a lie down. That was very kind of you. Thank you. What an amazing intro. Let's leave it there because I can't. Yeah, I don't know if I can live up to that. But yeah, well, thank you very much.
No problem. Well, welcome to the show, and and congratulations on getting your artwork in Star Wars Celebrations.
Thank you. Yeah,
real soon. For the fans who are watching on YouTube, I'm just going to put it up that your artwork. Oh, yeah. There you go. So you have done the piece of Andor, and it's called "For Every Day We Wait, They Get Stronger."
They get stronger, yeah.
They get stronger.
It felt like there's lots of amazing lines in the show that I felt like it had to be one of Cassian's lines, and you know, that one just felt it would sum up nicely, and you don't want your title to be too long.
I could
include all of Luthen's speech, and that would like be, you know, gone forever. But
God, he had such good speeches in that.
You know, so good.
It was that. Do you know? I have to say that when I was watching it, it's one of those series. But I think, to me, Lucasfilm sort of missed a trick here because it was so in depth and so long. It was like, you know, you sort of lose yourself on week to week. So I would have preferred that if they did like dropped half of it, all of it, half, and then a week or two later dropped the last half, because I ended up, every time I started watching the next episode, I had to watch the previous episode all the time I was going backwards and forwards. I enjoyed it. And my mind couldn't make up my mind on this. Like, it's just one of the greatest pieces of Star Wars that I've seen on TV, because it's telling you that gritty side of Star Wars that we see. Or is it just really boring? Because my son was like, what's happening with this? And I have to keep telling him. And then, but it had those real standout moments. And that bit with Luther, that was powerful stuff. That was really good writing.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, I think it did catch us out in the sense of like, it's such a slow burn, such a slow build, but the payoff for that is something that I don't feel like I'd felt that, you know, for a long time. And I found it really powerful, like those speeches and some of the things that, you know, it's kind of in like the season's kind of split, isn't it, into like these different, it builds to a few times throughout. And I just, in the end, I just found I was just like sort of deeply moved by it, like in a way that I can't remember thinking about, like, or in a way, like, yeah, it's a more adult Star Wars, whatever, but it took me back to that feeling as a kid, because it was like giving me goosebumps, you know, just like how powerful it was. So I just, so the initial submission date for the artwork, I think it was like back in November. So the series was still, it hadn't finished airing, and I was kind of basically when it was the episode for the eye, and you know, the asteroid, the colorful asteroid, you know, display.
Yeah.
That everyone's gathering around. That was the moment I was like, oh, that is the piece I want to do. Like this is the, because that's the thing, like thinking of what to submit for Star Wars Celebration, you can like go crazy because, especially if, you know, well, like so many of us, we love so many different aspects of Star Wars. So, you know, I could take any of the movies and do something, but I just had this sense of like, that where Andor was, I think there was maybe 3 episodes left. And I kind of had to get something in. You don't have to finish it at that point, but I had to submit like a work in progress. So that was when I kind of fully committed. Like, I know that this is really having a profound impact, which I don't think we quite get yet. And I think there's still a lot of people who probably haven't got around to seeing it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I have to say your artwork is fantastic. I love this
thank
one.
You.
I previously spoke with Jason Christman, who was on the show last time, and we paid particular attention to yours and the way I didn't notice it. Actually, he pointed it out, is the way that you've got Andy Serkis's shirt and I forgot what her character name is, sort of blends into the office. That is great.
Thank you. And it's like, I know, like, so I love a floating head collage, and I know it's not for everyone, but I know, because they use so much in marketing, like, and with photos, like with Photoshop, rather than being painted, you know, I get why they have a kind of a bad rep in a sense, but that was like the genre of post that I just grew up. I just loved because back in the day with Star Wars or anything, you know, if you were lucky, you got to see it at the cinema or, you know, so the first Return of the Jedi was the first film, first Star Wars I saw at the cinema. Before that, you know, as a kid in the UK, you're waiting for it to come onto TV at Christmas or, you know, a friend has the video. Like, we had a Betamax, we didn't have VHS.
Oh, so, you're one of those people.
Yeah, one of those weirdos, yeah. Well, my dad was. So the point was the posters could have such a profound impact because they were communicating the kind of the romance of, you know, of whatever was going to be in this movie that you maybe had only seen once or were never going to get around to seeing, or it might be years before you did. So I just always love that sense of putting all the characters in it. But yeah, and it's all, for me, it's about how do you tell that, what's the story of, like, the, you've got the hierarchy of characters. So on one hand, that's literally, you know, who's bigger than who. But I love the kind of puzzle of trying to figure out how to get that to work when you have so many.
Yeah.
And the goal is always like, have as few characters as you need, but have all the ones that you kind of have to. And in the case of this, it's true that I did end up adding more characters than I had in my initial version. But then it's like finding, like the thing about, I knew I wanted like that kind of corridor scene where he's going to the spaceship that's crash landed when he's a kid. And then obviously that gives you, you know, that gave me, you know, the central vanishing point.
Yeah.
And then it was later on that I sort of was looking for other things to get the atmosphere across. Because like, I wanted the sense of like, how do you get the Empire in there? And you want that kind of bureaucracy. And obviously that the office scene or their conference room is kind of the perfect way to show that. And on that, on its own, like, it's a beautifully designed location, but it's also like, obviously a conference room is boring, you know, by definition. But just when I saw the kind of the doorway and the angle of that, and I was, you know, still playing with where the characters were positioned. So the first thing I actually realized was like, that would play in nicely with the corridor. Mm-hmm. So I can, you know, if it's at a certain scale, the angle of the doorway is kind of going to match up with that vanishing point of the corridor close enough.
Yeah.
And then, realizing that, oh, look, the jacket and the crease in Andy Serkis, I can like make that all play into it. And then it's kind of reflecting up. And then the kind of the inverse is happening at the top. So I'm using like the mountains just to like, I'm not doing it literally. It's not exactly symmetrical in the same way, but using that to bounce your eyes up. And then obviously the spaceships and tying it all in, just things like using the screens and the kind of map lines. So yeah. those curves in the background, they kind of complement the the jackets, and they hold the characters in place. And yeah, so, you know, I love working on like the puzzle. And then when you've kind of solved that, then it's like, right, you know, go and work on every individual portrait, get them detailed, make sure you, you know, capture everybody.
Yeah.
As best you can, obviously. And it gradually starts to take shape, but,
I have to say, do you know the eye at the top? How did you get those colors? Because that looks just like the TV show. And because when I watched it on the TV show, I thought, ooh, but those graphics people were way stressed. And you've created it. That must have took a long time to create it so well. Get all those individual colors in and mix them well. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, thank you. I mean, I just... Again, it's just something I love to do. So, you know, I'm not a photorealist, and, you know,
really,
I want my stuff to feel like a painting. And I think partly, you know, when you see it, obviously here, we're just looking at the JPEG, and hopefully people come and say hi at Celebration, you'll be able to see the print and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then you can see the brushstrokes kind of thing. But yeah, it's about, I've always just loved the, just sort of taking something that exists, and it's like you're kind of trying to channel it through your own paint style. But you can just get lost, like working on something like that, you can just kind of get lost in it, you know, like you really get into a nice kind of flow state, working on the little details, getting the pinks, the yellows, the teals. Yeah, I mean, it looks so beautiful. So like I say, it just felt like that'd be an amazing way to kind of set the piece going. And obviously it's kind of the cool blues and greens, then kind of, they fade nicely with the empire, the whites and the gray, the kind of, you know, the pale grays, the bluey grays. So that was, it was like almost like the top and bottom kind of, you know, almost like hold it together, as it were.
Yeah.
Or make the mood work consistently. And then, you know, obviously you've got little splashes of red and orange in there as well.
I love the blues in it. Blue's one of my favorite colors, and it pops. And I think I said to Jason Christman, I said this one would particularly look good printed on like a metallic card. Do you remember those metallic top cards you used to be able to get? The ones with the shine.
Yeah.
You can get them kind of cards, or maybe printed on metal. So it really brings out those colours. And I think that'd be magic.
I would have loved to have done that. Yeah. Unfortunately, with this, we have to print everything up front. And, you know, it would have been amazing to do that. But it's such a risk because, you know, don't know how many you're going to sell. But, well, you know, you never know. Like, maybe that at some point there'll be a chance. Yeah. But as far as I know, this is only be, you know, in this one, just at Star Wars Celebration this year. And that's all. But, but no, absolutely. It's like, I can totally see that working. Yeah. Or holographic paper or something.
Yeah. I have to say, you know, you say you're not like a realistic, you know, for doing Facebook, you know, every single one of them, I know exactly who they are.
Oh, thank you. Oh yeah. No, I just mean like I'm a realist, but I definitely want it to feel like a painting as well. It's not going to that level where it's just, you kind of can't tell if it's a photo or a,
there is that as well, because I was thinking that is that a photo, such a, because but I know that you have painted all this, but the common thing you do hear about these kind of modern posters that have been put out for like Star Trek, Star Wars as well, is that they're just a Photoshop. Somebody's just sat in front of Photoshop and just grabbed a couple of images, whacked them on, big one in the middle, and then just shipped it, and then someone's just signed it off, which I think is a tragedy. And I think, how can you just sign off that? Is like, is that the best they can come up with?
Yeah, when this, totally.
Like, talented artists like yourself and the other people at the show as well that are just oozing with talent that could just put that kind of stuff out. And believe me, well, I do know that you've done covers for certain other magazines and stuff.
Yeah.
People buy those DVDs when they got those variant covers and
Blu-rays
and stuff like that. So, you know, why?
Yeah.
And I used to buy posters when I was a kid. You know, the big ones you used to get. When I loved putting them up, but now I think, nah, I could probably do better myself. You know what I mean?
Thank you. But like, also, I feel like with those, you know, the Photoshop kind of marketing that you see, you'd have to be behind the scenes to know for sure. But I think, like, I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of it is like designed by committee, where there's maybe like a younger designer working on it, and then there's like some, at least one person, but maybe two or three people who are also kind of in the mix saying, well, what if you try this over here? And so it ends up being, it's the classic, a camel is a horse designed by committee, you know. And I think that's what you see a lot of the time. But it's partly the problem, that is because they're all photographic. Whereas when you give that work to like a painter, it's all going through that painter's style. So yeah. you automatically, like, in theory, you could have a terrible composition, but at least if it's painted, that would sort of solve some of the problems. But obviously someone who's an artist in this world is also used to planning these compositions carefully. So, and the thing you see all the time in those things as well is like all the eye lines of characters are just like leading you kind of out of the image and or all over the place. So, you know, one of the things I'm trying to do here as much as possible is you want the viewer's gaze to be held in the composition as much as possible.
Yeah.
So like characters looking at each other kind of across the middle, or, you know, you've got like, mine's going to go blank, but Melshi looking up at Andor, and, you know, it's all those little, so there's these extra kind of relationships you can have going on within the piece, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I have to say, you know, some of the characters, I'm going to see if I can just put it up on my PC, so we can sort of zoom in on it. There you go. Mon Mothma. I've learned from Palpatine, I show you the stone in my hand and you miss the knife throat. Brilliant.
Yeah. So many, there's so many good lines. And to be honest, like, you know, we had like the pre-orders were open for like 10 days, I think. So, so as you know, we're always thinking about what you can do on social media. Like people have seen the piece, so you don't just want to post the same thing again. So that I just was thinking like, oh, there's so many great lines, so it would be actually nice to kind of do a post where I just take out the individual portraits, and have a line, you know, just a simple idea. But it was quite fun, like going back for the show and, you know, looking them up. And
she looks fantastic. Look, the eyes and the even got the earring. It's great.
Well, yeah. So I think, yeah, you can see there, like you can clearly see that it is painted. And I think, it's like when you're zoomed out and it's just the JPEG, like people are looking on their phones, you can't necessarily see like how it's been kind of made.
Let's see if I can zoom in on another one. Here we go. Right. So hopefully, there we go.
Yay.
Next one. Yes. Got there in the end.
So anyway,
one of my favorite droids. This droid
turned
out to be, I felt really sorry for it.
Brilliant.
I want to be alone. I want to be with Mar-Vell. And I was like,
I know. I think like,
EMO.
What a character. Because, you know, I was thinking, kind of droided out, or you know, there's plenty of great droids obviously that we all know and love. But they managed to bring in an extra brilliant one and give it a dimension we've never seen before, you know.
The idea
of a droid kind of having like depression or and loneliness is really powerful.
Well, funny enough, because they reckon that like R5-D4 that's in the Mandalorian is a sort of a sentient Jedi aware, I think, force sensitive droid.
Oh, right. Okay.
Apparently a comic book made it canon, and that's why he blew his own rotavator out so they would pick R2-D2. When I was a kid, I always thought R2-D2 shot it. I really did.
Oh, really? Right.
Shot him, yeah. So that kind of, you know, when you think about that, maybe that a droid is actually force sensitive. This droid really gives you the impression that of someone who's suffered from loss and has gone into a depression. And then when Andor finally turns up, he's like, oh, you know what I mean? I want to be with you, please. You know, and didn't everyone's heart just like, you know, fall when he got kicked over in that battle? Like,
yes, absolutely. And then, like, and also, you know, the best use of a droid is a projector.
Yes.
Since, oh, yeah, yeah. Know, well, since, like, New Hope, maybe, you know.
It also reminded me, in a better way, do you know how it sort of folded down in itself?
Yeah.
It reminded me of, do you remember the Black Hole? Do you remember the two droids, Vincent and Old Bob? They could sort of collapse themselves in. Yeah. And pop themselves out.
Yeah.
Give me that sort of vibe of Old Bob. Harry would collapse in, then just his head would just peep out to have a look round, sort of thing.
Yeah, which also plays into the character so well. Like, you know, like it's sort of introverted.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, such good. Brilliant. And you've done, just zooming in, all that rust. I tell you what, you would be great at weathering models and armor.
maybe if things don't work out as an artist, but no, you know, a bit like painting the eye, you know, anything like that, I love getting into that, you know, up to a point, you know, like I say, it's taking it far enough where you just feel like it's got the texture. So having to play with some different brushes and
it's fantastic. And of course we've got Serkis.
Kino Loy, and Serkis, like, oh man, like, what, like, he was just so great. And when you first, I don't know about you, but like, when he was first in it, I was like, okay, well, I guess he's just like the manager guy. And he, you know, he maybe won't be in it that much.
Yeah.
Or, you know, and then he plays such an important role. In fact, it kind of annoyed me. Like, I had to use that quote, but it annoyed me because all the others are on two lines. But like, I had to use Never More Than 12, and it's just like, that's it. It's just the perfect.
Yeah, well, he had a longer speech, didn't he?
He does. Yeah.
You couldn't put all that there.
No. But when he says that again, it's one of those moments in the show that's just so powerful, and it's because it's taken him so long to give that up. You know, because he's so reticent to engage with this idea that, you know, they should try and escape. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's fantastic. And of course, that looks like Andy Serkis, 100%. You've got how you've done his brush strokes on his beard. I wish I could get my beard like that. That looks ace. That is brilliant. You've captured him 100%, 100% on that. It's fantastic. And of course, Andor himself, Cassian Andor. Of course, I'm afraid, but there's a difference between fear and losing your nerve. Wow.
Yeah, I mean,
it looks fantastic.
Thank you.
Done him a treat. To be fair, your poster is one of those posters that, you know, if you're there at celebrations and you buy Sam's poster, you could get it signed by a lot of the people that are actually in the program.
That's true. I mean? Yeah.
And then that be something, because Dago Luna is going to be there, as well as because
that's right. Yeah.
Special Andor panel, aren't they?
Yeah. So,
wouldn't it be great to get this piece signed? You know what I mean?
Oh, I mean, I'd love to see people getting that to happen. And obviously, when you're making it, like, you're not even thinking of that because you don't know no one's been announced at that point. But yeah, that would be really special.
Yeah, yeah. And his eyes, you know, you get that. I always find it's hard to, you know, you could do a portrait, but getting the eyes right, I always find is a thing, and
yeah,
you got him bang on them. Yeah, I mean,
he's got it's an intense expression, and I went back a bit back and forth on it a little bit of like looking at, you know, different expressions that he has, but I just felt like it's that intensity that he has, and that actually is what, you know, that's the kind of energy of the show, of his character. So I kind of felt, no, let's having him scowling as much as possible is actually good.
Are you any good at animation? Because I'd love to see an animation of of your portraits, because I think if there was this kind of quality in an animation show, I'd watch it.
Well, I mean, I guess that's the thing. Get an AI to do it and put us all out of work. But the thing is, that's the thing. I mean, it would be amazing, but it'd just take so long. You know, like this is sort of like, I don't know, at least a month of work, really.
Yeah.
So that's like, if that's one frame of an animation, you know, might take a while.
Yeah. Now you say it. Yeah.
No, but at the same time, you know, one thing that, you know, as you probably know, like things like on Instagram, you're encouraged to, or like videos can perform better, like reels and stuff. So I think about, you know, I did a montage of kind of moving around the piece. And then I also put in some of the, I recorded some of the painting process. So if people want to go on my Instagram, they would see that, in fact. But one other way to do it would be like, way I've painted it is I've painted a bit extra of all the characters. So I haven't had time, but in theory, you could at least have like a kind of parallax effect, like move around the poster and like the characters would slightly move, and that would be cool. So maybe at some point I'll do that.
Yeah.
No, I'm not an animator as such, but I can move stuff around a little bit.
Yeah. This one is good as well. Marvel Andor, you've captured her. I can't remember what the actress's name, except that I only just watched her in Super Mario Brothers that came out in the early 80s. Yeah, she was in it she's young in it. And she drinks a drink with a worm in it. I think I remember listening to her doing a TV interview about it. And she says the director said it was going to be like a fake worm, but it weren't. It was a real one. She drank it. Yeah. But she was fantastic in it. Fantastic actress. And of course, she's in the Harry Potter films as well.
Yeah, of course she is. I'm going to have to look her up now. Fiona Shaw.
That's it. Fiona Shaw.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's a great actress, and she's been in so much stuff. Mostly, like the younger folks will know her from the Harry Potter series, but films. But she was great in this. And you know when that projection where she's doing it,
that
speech. Wow, you know what I mean? That was great. You know, doing an uprising, the reckoning. It's great. Yeah, it's just, I thought it was great.
so good.
Let's go to the next one. Now, she looks like she's always sucking on a mint. Miro.
Yeah,
have I got that right?
Miro, I think. Yeah, Miro, played by
Denise Goff. Yes, she is a smiling actress. I've seen her smile in a.
She can smile, but wasn't required in this.
She were great though, weren't she? She was absolutely fantastic in this, and I was expecting her character at some point to appear in the Bad Batch maybe or something like that, because because they are doing a season two, so you know they're going to be bringing her back in. And she's got what I liked about her character is she's got her eyes further on up the tree, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
She wanted those sectors, didn't she? She wanted to take over, because they kept saying she ain't even in charge of that sector. What does she want to do with that? You know, on the little bit, she just wants to move up that ladder. Yeah. And she's British as well. So, you know, I mean, it's Brits in the Star Wars universe are quite evil.
Yeah, playing evil people. Yeah.
Yeah.
But she's great. And then, like, the whole thing, and again, the payoff with Cyril Khan, you know, behind her there, like, because he ends up rescuing her at the end.
I haven't got him.
Whereas,
let's just see if I can bring him up. Let's just see. Bring up the next batch, actually.
Because she's kind of quite condescending towards him throughout.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then suddenly, she now owes him a debt, you know.
Yeah.
Again, like Tony Gilroy is just a genius. I think we can all agree on that.
Yes, I'll agree on that. Let me just bring them up. Details there. It's 12. Done it again. Hold on a second. Open. Dush. Right, there we go. So let me just close that one and open up another one. Oh, the joys of computer power, I'll tell you. Windows. Right. Let's go down. There he is. There he goes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you know his character?
Brilliant. Yeah. Creepy.
He was creepy. Do you know what he reminded me of? Captain Scarlet. One of those.
The cap is very.
Yeah. And do you know that whole thing? It's because, you know, when we know that Andor started off doing some pretty bad things, which he sort of got forced into, you know, spoilers for the show, folks, if you're not seeing it. And but the whole thing was going to be dropped, wasn't it? But this guy
just wanted to
prove a point. And we get those where if you got a job and you work for the boss man, you've always got one that wants to just put you down and get ahead. And this is this.
Yeah, absolutely. Take the smallest thing and like say, pick it up, run with it. Keep on the trail kind of thing.
Yeah. His mum were pretty creepy in it as well.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And even stuff like him eating like the blue cereal and things like that. And it was the little details of it that were so like, that you just, I don't know, not saying I was like wanting to watch people eat cereal in Star Wars, but it was like, it was the way that with the pacing they could do that.
Yeah.
And you know, have a look at their normal lives kind of thing.
Yeah. And it seemed to me that the reason he wanted to prove himself is because his mother put him down all the time, treated him like a child. And like you say, the blue milk with the Cheerios. Yeah. You know what I mean, I must smell
Cheerios. Lot, yeah.
But you know what I mean? But you want to be a man? No, I'll have Weetabix, not Cheerios. You know what I mean? So she was always getting, so it was always that pecking, that putting him down. So you can see why that he did what he did, because he wants to prove that he's the bigger man. He wants to go forward, and it seemed to give you the impression that his mum wanted to sort of like hang out in the high society, because as you know with Coruscant, the lower you are, is the lower and the ladder you are, isn't it?
Yeah, where you live. Yeah.
But fantastic. It really is good with that.
Yeah, and then having him just behind Miro as well, you know, in the composition just made sense, you know.
Who did we miss? Right. Right. Oh, we'll go on to Luther, yeah. Skarsgård, of course. Fantastic. Yeah. And I burn my life to make a sunrise that I never, ever see. Well, I never see. Powerful stuff. You know what I mean? Especially when that guy comes down the lift and goes, no, I just want out.
And then
he gives you that speech, just like, maybe I'll stay then. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's so intense and like what a monologue. Brilliant.
It is. You've got him perfect, can I say? You know, you got his nose, his eyes, the how he, you know, his mouth, that, you know, that look. I have to say, you know, Sam, in all these people in your poster, they all look like him. You know what I mean? Every single one looks like them. I can zoom in now on this one. Oh, that's pretty better now. Yeah. On your main poster, when you were saying about it, I missed that detail in the middle is young Andor getting on board that crash ship at the on one of the flashbacks.
Yeah.
I missed it. I totally missed it until I looked at it again. so it was because for some reason my mind just kept thinking it was a part of a logo, you know what I mean?
Right. Well, it's interesting because the use of like you've got the prison. Now that's not a hexagon. I think it's like there's a seven sided. It's like is it a septagon? Mm. I'm not sure now. Yeah. I'd have to look. But you know that just the use of geometric shapes, obviously. It's always good to utilize that in a composition if you can.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think as well, I mean, I've got to be honest, I love a good sort of space corridor. I love a good science fiction corridor.
Yeah, I do. Funny enough, I wonder if I was looking at some as a background for today, but I just meant what I've got. But
it instantly sort of says science fiction.
Yeah. And
if
creepy.
If you have a corridor. Creepy. Yeah,
because
creepy
we corridor. Know all those science fiction films, you know, with the slow panning across an empty space corridor.
Absolutely.
You think, oh, God. You know what I mean? And recently, they've just done that with the Bad Batch in a couple of their episodes with the creepy corridors. Do you know, looking at this bit, you know, Sam, it must have been a real pain in the bum doing all these panels around where he's going, because each one is perfect. You know what I mean? Round and round and round.
Well, thank you. Well, I'll be honest, what I was able to do there, and this is where, you know, I work whilst I sort of, I'm painting everything by hand, you know, I'm working digitally. So in this case, like with it being symmetrical, I was able to kind of paint the main shadows of each of the panels and then kind of arrange them and like duplicate the sort of shadow.
Yeah.
And then paint kind of underneath and above that to get the lighting.
To get the light
In different, you know, because obviously the shadow's falling a bit differently from different angles and stuff. But yeah, so the main shape was, you know, I did repeat it. And then you kind of paint into it and then you add texture and stuff. Again, another one of those things that like, it sort of looks tedious, but actually they're the bits I especially love.
Because
you just kind of lose yourself in it.
Do you know with these... You know, when you look at the whole, do you know how you get these white lines that you've put around some of the characters? And you know, when you zoom right in, you can see the detail around here in the face. It's very much to me like a Drew, what's his name?
Drew Struzan, yeah,
yes,
his the master, kind of, really, yeah. I mean, it's interesting because, like, obviously, you know, he's the arguably the greatest master of that style. So it's kind of weird because, you know, I'm a massive fan of his, obviously. You can see that influence.
Yeah.
But equally, you know, you're sort of trying to find your own kind of way to do things. Mm. Like where he worked was like, or, you know, he's retired now, but like still with us, fortunately. But like his stuff is all like pencils. So he's like doing really detailed pencils first and then kind of painting and airbrushing around that. With my stuff, it's more painterly by the end of it. I don't really have much like kind of cross hatching stuff.
But the
one of the things that he does really well is like having this extra edge on things. And what I've realized is when sometimes I kind of utilize that, sometimes I don't. But when you have a lot of characters, it just helps, because in this case with a montage, the whole point is these characters are not in the same physical space. It's kind of like you're looking at each one individually. They're all different sizes, right? So it's not like they're in the same room. So that having that edge is just a way of kind of breaking up that kind of illusion. I just find it just gives this little bit of an extra bit of style and a little bit of a kind of break around everything that just kind of frees it up a little bit.
I love it.
Yeah.
Do you know?
That's the thing. It just works.
The other thing as well is it looks like it's moving. You get the, you know, with the eye at the top, and you've got the sort of like the lines to say that you're moving in or you're pulling out.
Yeah, and it's also like using a bit of the hyperspace effect as well at the edges, you know. So it's just sort of in the middle section at the edges. I've got the kind of hyperspace effect because Luthen, when he speeds off in his ship. When it does the thing with the lasers and it's magic, because you're not expecting it.
No. I somebody's actually done a 3D print of his ship, and I'm quite tempted to buy it so I can 3D print it, because it's very nice. Yeah. There's one character on here that is actually missing, and that's the drum guy. You know, the guy
I did look at trying to include the tower.
Yeah.
And I went through various things, and in the end, I felt like having the young Andor felt like that could work as a sort of it's his show, So, and it's about his journey. So have it, and the flashbacks, obviously, they're not, and there's not too many of them, but just it gives you this sense of like how he started out on this kind of journey.
They certainly learned their lesson from the Book of Boba with the amount of flashbacks.
Oh man,
Oh,
well, I think I might prefer the flashbacks in Boba to some of the other stuff, but
do you know, talking about Boba, I would say I would love to see a fan edit where they put all the flashbacks before, and then the rest of it afterwards. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I'd like to see that. Than the way it was, because it was like, oh, back to the back tank. Oh, here we go again.
It was all a dream.
Oh god, yeah.
It was all a flashback.
It was a flashback. Han Solo is still alive. Yeah. Back on this one, then Saw Gerrera. I'm the only one with clarity and purpose. Yeah. You've got his eyes perfect on this with Forrest Whitaker, because he's got like a lazy eye, hasn't he?
Yeah, perfectly imperfect. Hopefully, yeah. You know, it's trying. Yeah. Be flattering and but also be accurate, you know. I mean, he's got a brilliant face to draw. Like, I love it. Yeah. He was a character that I very nearly didn't include.
All right.
Because I was thinking of it in terms of like who is important to Andor in the show. Because when I realized I was going to need quite a lot of characters. You know, I was kind of thinking, is there anyone I can take out? Because fewer is, you know, like I say, it's like as many as you need, but as few as you can get away with, sort of thing.
Yeah.
Because they do get very busy, you know. But in the end, again, he just works really well behind Luthen.
Yes, he does. You got that sort of the resistance building there.
Yeah.
So he had to be there.
But
the other character that... that perhaps, I don't know, would have been all right on it, or perhaps not, is, do you know Luther's assistant?
Yeah.
But she looks so much like Carrie Fisher that I think if anyone drew her on a poster, they go, is Princess Leia in that?
Yeah, she wasn't in Andor, yeah. Well, again, I thought of it like, I thought about her, but then I thought, obviously I've got Mon Mothma, but really, when like Luthen is on Coruscant, he's in disguise there.
Mm.
That's not his true self, in you know, really. Like he's kind of faking it, you know, with his wig and, you know, with his kind of antique store, whatever it is. So again, she just felt like, and maybe in season two she'll be more significant. But it was also like, you know, Cassian didn't meet her.
Yeah, that's right.
So that felt like someone that I could do without for now. Season two, who knows? But yeah.
Yeah.
And then this guy actually as well, like he's not in it that much, but I figured like he had to be because he's so important.
Yeah.
Like his manifesto and his speeches are actually
for this guy.
Oh yeah, totally. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
He put all that work in with his, you know, his kind of like, you know, his like militant. You know, his sense of like trying to convey to everyone else what they were up against and why it was so important. But and then in the end, you know, I think but he has, but what he does is really he does get through to Cassian.
Yes, he did.
And you see like that's like the character arc of Cassian over the show is I think really influenced by this guy.
Yeah. If you try remembering back to it, it's because of what he says, this Kerris says to Andor, that do you know when that other member of the team says, look, let's just cut and run, let's leave him.
That's right.
Well, Andor kills him. Andor just shoots him because he says, nah, there's something bigger, you know, that lad is dying for us, and you're willing to cut them all free, you know what I mean? You know, the guy that plays him is a fantastic young actor. I've seen him in numerous stuff, and he was fantastic in this Andor. You know what I mean? Totally believable. You know what I mean? Yeah. That, you know, such a young actor, young character that believes in something bigger and to be free of the Empire. Do you know what I mean? It's great.
Absolutely. Well, it's like got echoes of, in a way, of like Luke, in the sense of like the sort of naivety. Well, I guess Luke is more just kind of keen to escape, to get away from his boring life, whereas this guy has, you know, has an agenda. But it's certainly that kind of, that, I don't know, like, knows it's, they're up against something massive, but yeah, knowing that, yeah, you have to be kind of fully committed to want to break that system, like that, yeah, that thing. I mean, this is from like a much longer monologue, but yeah, the kind of, this is like the start and the end of it, but the struggle is going to seem impossible, but you know, they're having that mentality that one, at a certain point, you know, it's the straw that breaks the camel's back kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is, and you could argue that that's what, you know, and that's what obviously leading into Rogue One, it's all about, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it is. And, do you know, I love Rogue One. if, you know, I'm not a particular big fan of the Disney era trilogy, I have to say. They have their aspect, but if I had to, you know my go-to films, if there, someone says, right, you've got to watch a Disney era Star Wars film, what's it going to be? Andor, straight off. Rogue One, sorry, straight on. I love that. Yeah, yeah. I've watched that numerous times. And did you ever see that animation on YouTube called How It Should Have Ended?
Oh yeah, right? I've seen that.
They had a right plausible way of of saving the characters, and I was like, oh man, why could they have not do that? I was like, if I was Disney, I'd be like, yeah, get that on film right now, get it on film, we'll use that.
But I think it's because that they don't survive, that again, that's maybe why it's so good, because like, I don't know, like one of the things I found with, I mean, let's not get into the new ones, but you know, Rise of Skywalker, almost like where they sort of teased in the trailer that like C-3PO was gonna die, and he really just doesn't, and there's no, you know, I think we were kind of almost ready to lose more, in episode 9 maybe.
Yeah. Well, they sort of got scared, didn't they, with that, because they sort of did that with Chewie. And they must have gone, oh no, we can't, because it was like literally a minute later you found out, no, he's alive.
Yeah, but then of course, you know, but then again, you know, in Force Awakens that doesn't pull the punch, because you know, Han Solo dies. So anyway, but the point is, what I feel about Andor and Rogue One though is almost like I've always loved Star Wars in all its different forms, but there's something about them, by going that little bit deeper into, to me, they've kind of elevated all of Star Wars, because they're sort of showing what they're really up against, like what against, you know, fascism, and what the Empire is really prepared to do. Like if you think about like what happens to Bix in the show, and like in the, you know, they don't hold back on that, on the, you know, the torture side of it.
Yeah.
And previously in Star Wars, that's just been like, you know, you go in a dark room, in the Death Star or whatever, and there's, they really show like the kind of the effects of that, and it's powerful.
You could quite easily swap out Andor for the French Resistance, a World War II series, quite easily. Because in the end, because I was trying to tell my son about it, I was like, if you look at the way the Empire dress and act, they are, you know what I mean, they are Nazi party, you know what I mean, back in the way they're portrayed, because it's like even in the show, they are quite, you know, I mean, you know, one says just flippantly, oh, do you mind if we just hang a couple of people outside? And she says, yeah, whatever. Now you think, what?
Yeah.
You don't usually see that in a Star Wars film, you know what I mean?
No,
so it was pretty good. Yeah, it was pretty good. And a lot of people must have missed this, because I've spoken to a couple of people that have watched Rogue One. This Mellish,
Melchi,
that's it. He's actually in Rogue One.
yeah, that's right. Yeah,
he's in Rogue One, and everyone was like, "Is he?" I was like, "Yeah."
Well,
he was,
you know, I think it's partly like the success of like the prison outfits, which, you know, meant to make everyone look the same. So because he's, you know, I mean, I guess he's technically a few years older, even though he's meant to be younger here. But, you know, I think just not Star Wars, so much of it is conveyed by the outfits, you know, that to recognize a character.
Yeah.
And obviously with these kind of generic uniforms on, you could miss him. But again, he was like one of those ones like in, you could argue that in Andor, like he doesn't get much screen time. Mm. But when they escape and, you know, it's him and Cassian.
Yeah.
It's what he says to him. It's like, you know, we need to. You know, they're working out what to do next, and he's the one saying, "Look, we need to tell people what's happening. Because yeah. What if we're the only ones who survived? You know,
because it again, quite seemed it, didn't it?
Yeah, yeah, and, yeah.
They were the only ones that managed. Because poor Andy Serkis said he couldn't swim. I was like, oh man, what a bummer.
I know. Yeah. You think? Yeah, I don't know. We'll see. I mean, surely, I think he'll be back in season two, yes. Won't he?
I think so. He's such a
he'll have found character. A raft or something. It'll be like,
yeah,
he'll be like Rose in Titanic. He'll have found a wardrobe.
Yeah, absolutely. So that was them. So you know, absolutely fantastic. I just want to because we talked about this earlier, Sam, that you've done some yeah. other work. And now let me see if I can just add them. Open up. There we go. Right. So, like you was kind enough to share some early work of yours.
Very early work, yeah.
Very early work, which my son appreciated because my son wants to take up art and he's slowly getting there, but he says, oh, I'm crap, all this lot. And I keep saying, just practice makes perfect. Now, this is a prime example, ladies and gentlemen, of what practice makes. Yeah. So these drawings... are by Sam. How old were you, Sam, when you made these ones?
39. about six or seven, I think.
And you kept them?
Well, my mum kept them and my dad kept them. So, you know, to be honest, it's and I've got to say, you know, they were great. They're still with us, but they kept me in paper and pencils, and you know, I kind of just drew all the time. You know, like, and like so many kids, like, but yeah, it was good of them to keep them as well. I kept yeah. so many of them, but yeah, yeah. I would just, I think it's that thing of like, I guess I had, I don't know, comics and you kind of, anything you could kind of grab, like some kind of movie adaptation book, you'd have all these things, you know, because it might be years before you saw the movie again or whatever. So you had to kind of,
yeah.
remember it in your head really, and or any little clipping from a magazine would be so precious.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, you know, I just like, you know, I just loved like drawing all this stuff and making this little action
one,
scenes.
I like this one. This one, you've got all the goings all, on here with this.
It's all going on, yeah.
Yeah, you've got the AT-AT slowly being pulled over. You got the rebel soldiers shooting at the legs. You've yeah. got the snow speeders. It's got looks it all. Like a till receipt.
Oh, you know, what it is, so my dad was a computer programmer.
We'll see.
So what he'd bring home all these reams of paper.
Yeah.
That they, whatever, that there was like on one side, there'd be code that they didn't need. So yeah, that's part, yeah. All my stuff yeah. was on this kind of paper.
And the best bit about it, Sam, is whatever you've shot just there, yeah, there's the guy falling from it. Ah! Yeah, how cool is that? We like it. We like a good AT-AT here at Radio Free Endall. That's good. I love that one. Yeah, I mean, I absolutely love that. My son loved it. He was like, "Wow!"
I think and I had an AT-AT as well, so I was probably using that one for reference.
I've got an AT-AT, but believe it or not, I only got it about 6 years ago. It's the one toy I never got when I was a kid because I was lucky enough to be around. When Star Wars first came out, I was only seven.
Yeah, well, me too. Yeah.
Really? How old are you?
Well, I'm 46, so I was born in 77. Yeah. So yeah. It was a few years later, obviously.
Yeah, yeah,
but
yeah.
But like I say, so Return of the Jedi was when I was properly into it because that was when it was out of the cinema. Yeah.
But you know, so my mum had sort of a direct line to Palatoy because I lived in Leicester. We were brought up in Leicester, and she had somebody that came to her bingo who worked at Palatoy. So they kept having like,
they
went stuff in the boot of their car and sell it to me mum. Wow. But the one thing they couldn't get out was an AT-AT because it was so popular. So I ended up buying myself one. Yeah.
I had a few things. Atta was one of the few things I had, but I don't know why I've got Luke with a like Bobber's jetpack there, I think.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
That's not canon. But yeah.
Yeah, and there's Vader going, yes, impressive.
Yeah, get me if you can, yeah.
Yeah, and some stormtroopers, I like how that one's got proper blasted. And that is a proper action shot. That looks just like Han Solo, because there is actually some, like a publicity photo where he's like that, giving that sort of look.
Maybe I'd seen that. It's hard to, obviously I don't remember, but yeah. Yeah, it's all come from somewhere.
How creepy Chewie looks. Looks proper angry, doesn't it? Look at that look.
He's angry at being at the edge of the paper with holes.
it's great. It absolutely fantastic.
It's the classic thing as a kid where you run out of space because you don't plan it.
Yeah. And of course, Han Solo and Chewbacca victorious. Yeah. Now, this is got to be an Endor one because of the fern.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I guess so. The yellow, that yellow stripe. Like, I didn't get around to colouring the rest of it.
Look at Chewie. That's fantastic. You know, who gave Han a black eye? You know what I mean?
One of the Ewoks, probably.
Yeah, probably. Look at this. R2, stop being silly. It's only Chewbacca. But that's great. You know, the Falcon at the top.
Yeah, I think that's like the beginning of starting to play with like collages and I guess seeing all that stuff in the original, like the Thomas Chantrell, you know, the original poster. I remember being like kind of entranced by that, like all the characters like the wrong size, like again to be in the same space. But overall it just has this kind of magical quality with like the Death Star and Vader looming behind and little X-Wings. And
do you know, I've done it myself, Sam. I've done it myself. Now these ones are pretty cool. You sent me The Last Jedi. Were these like comic variations or what?
So this was like the first official work I ended up doing, which was just a few little kind of, basically there was another artist who'd worked on this. I've got the book here. I don't want to get their name wrong. Cyril Nouvel. So he had done the vast majority, or they had done the vast majority of the drawings in this. I think it was like a tight deadline and they just needed a bit of help. So they brought me in to kind of, and I was just echoing the style that he was already doing. So like, as you've seen from my stuff, it's pretty detailed.
Yeah.
And it's painterly. And in this case, it was more like doing a few drawings, basically. I just did a few. This is like a journal book. So it's like a hardback. Well, I've got it. In fact, I've got it here.
Ah.
So it's it's like, the idea is it's written from the perspective of Rose. Like, she's written this journal.
Yeah.
So it's got like a kind of hand-drawn kind of typography, and it's got all these like sketches throughout it and stuff like that.
Is that a picture from it?
Yeah, the Dreadnought one, I think. Yeah. Is, yeah.
Oh, still gone. That's one.
And that, yeah, so that's a few. Well. That one's from the other book. So that I did a few for the Rose book, and then I did all of the illustrations for a book called Tales from Vandor. Solo, a Star Wars story. So
yeah,
this was like an amazing, fun opportunity. Like, I think you got a few there, but
They are fantastic,
you know. And they were just I think I had, it was a crazy deadline, I remember. I think it was three weeks to do about 80 drawings. And if you imagine, like, so something like my Andor poster, that's like a month of work where I'm really going to town on the details. This was kind of changing that mindset to be like, again, meant to be more sketchy and throwaway. As if, now which character's perspective is it written from? But the both books are by Jason Fry.
Mm.
Oh, that's right. It's written from like a bartender's perspective. On Vandor, and that's where they meet at the the bar that's there and stuff.
Yeah.
And I got to draw a few Landos and Tobias Beckett's and L337, and so it's great. Like, it was very intense and not my normal kind of style in a way, but it was kind of getting it down to the essence of what I do, which is, I don't know,
fantastic. That.
Trying to still capture people's likeness, more with the outline than the shading, I guess. But then just getting the lighting in there that, you know, just enough kind of, I love playing with lighting and, just getting enough things in there where it had some energy to it. So that was, you know, that was like the rose one was nice, but that I just did like, I don't know, 5 or 6 drawings. That felt like the first kind of proper project.
Yeah.
And then, later on ended up doing the Empire covers that you think you might also have there.
Yes. I've got some here. Let's open up again.
I mean, I quite enjoyed the movie Solo.
I know it didn't
do too great, but it made them put everything on hold.
It did.
In terms of the movies, which is maybe what's led to some great stuff like, you know, Mando and everything.
Well, I think the problem with Solo is it was technically a film that we didn't need. Yeah.
Yeah.
But once I'd seen it, I was like, do you know what? That were really good. I enjoyed that. But they put it out too close to the Rise of Last Skywalker. Last Jedi.
Last Jedi, yeah.
And because of the how,
it was right, yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But because of how bad that film was received, it put a stale taste in people's mouths, so that it didn't take off. But I enjoyed it.
The standalone thing.
Yeah, and I would. Do you know it would make a fantastic TV series? I really do. If they ever decide to go down there. Now these ones are great. I love these Empire ones. Now, for people in the States, Empire magazine is a film review magazine, and if you subscribe, you often get a subscription edition cover compared to the regular one you get off the stand. These two here that you've done, Sam, is one of them like a subscription one and one's a normal one, or are they just
they're both subscriptions different? But they're for season 1 and 2, so the first one on the left is that's for season 1, and that was coming out when, if you remember, like Disney Plus didn't launch at the same time, so it's a bit of a weird situation where we all knew about Grogu, or as he was then known, Baby Yoda, or the child. So this was actually like in like March when Disney Plus launched in the UK. So the character was already like, you know, created a massive, you know, all the hype and everything. So we all knew. So it wasn't like the surprise it had been, you know, when the show was first aired everywhere, or in the US, I guess. But yeah, they and obviously, but Mandalorian plays into all of those Western tropes, as of course you know the original Star Wars did, or you know samurai films too, of course. So Empire kind of had this kind of cool idea, which was like, let's have. Well, I mean, there it is, but it was kind of weird because it was like the idea was to hide Grogu behind the poster. And I was like, I remember being like, but I want to, he's so cute and everyone loves him. I want to draw his face, you know, the whole thing.
Yeah.
But it was really kind of cool, kind of playing into this, like, painting Mando and then working out the design of the Wanted poster and using Aurabesh and everything was a lot of fun. Yeah. But at that time, like, I had no idea they were going to come back to me again for season 2. So it's just a standalone thing. So then for season 2, it's trying to work out how I could do something that really was a companion piece. So, you know, simple idea, but the kind of angle of Grogu's ears, it's like reversed. So it's like, it's all kind of like a mirror kind of composition.
Yeah.
Using the diagonal. Yeah. And then, you know, I was able to get the ship in there and then also finally draw his face and the cookies.
The cookies, yes. I was going to ask you about that, but you know, on your cover one, did you know before you put the poster there, did you actually do the whole of his face and then put the poster on top, or did you just do that bit?
Just that bit, because it was like a very clear kind of, this is what we're going to do. And also there wasn't, I seem to remember there wasn't that long. It was a classic kind of, it's an amazing opportunity. I was so excited to do it, but I didn't have as long as I would have liked to do it. So there was like, sometimes with a collage type poster, I paint extra, you know, even if I think I've got the composition I want of where they overlap, I paint extra because you just never know. Like later on, you might go, I could just move them a little bit or make them a bit smaller or whatever.
Yeah.
You need those extra bits. But something like this is kind of, you're locked in. This is the one thing you're doing.
Yeah.
So you just kind of go for it. Yeah.
Yeah. This season 2 poster, it looks like he's took out the Empire logo from the top. Is that the way it's supposed to be?
Yeah. Yeah. It is. Yeah. I mean, again, it was. I'm not gonna lie, yeah, that was a bit of a challenge, because that, again, it was like they were really clear that they wanted that, and I wouldn't necessarily pitch that, but actually in the end, well, I think what worked well was like having that as a cutout and then you're seeing the blue through it.
Yeah,
so again, it becomes this, whereas the sort of season 1 is the sort of the desert and the kind of the warm version, then this is the cold. So yeah, so actually I was pleased with how it turned out, but at the time I was like, oh no, how am I going to get that to work?
It's so detailed. Thanks. Do you know, originally, how big is this? You know what I mean? Because of course your magazine is so big, but you know, when you're drawing it, how big is it? You know, if it was a poster, would it be a really big poster?
I treat everything that I do as if it could be a poster. So yeah, I do work on them bigger.
Mm.
Partly because, like, one thing I remember when I was a kid, around the time of those early drawings, maybe actually a few years later, so when I kind of discovered comics, I used to love, what if you drew on an A3 bit of paper and you drew a comic, and if you do it in felt tip, obviously it's not perfect blacks and you get these grays in it, but then when you photocopy it and you shrunk it to A4, like half the size, everything looked really sharp and crisp and like better than I'd drawn it, as it were.
Yeah.
So it's sort of, I don't know, something that I've always taken. Like if you basically work on something bigger than you need to.
Yeah.
And then when you shrink it, it's going to sort of keep that detail in it. And again, it's a benefit of working digitally. You know, if it was literally a case of, you know, you're working a certain size of canvas.
Yeah.
Then, you know, you're only as kind of detailed as your smallest brush, as it were.
Yeah.
But by working on a bigger canvas, and also, you know, so if you're painting for real, to do more detail, you need a bigger canvas. So if you see a lot of photorealistic painters, they actually work on a huge scale. So it's the same thing. You have to stand at the other side of the gallery, like, what's his name? Chuck Close, if you look at his stuff. If you're up close, it's abstract. And it's only when you're like 50 feet away that it's photorealistic. But when you work digitally, what you can do is you can kind of zoom out. So you can work on the whole canvas at once, as it were.
Yeah.
And then as you need to, you can zoom in closer to get those finer details. But the point is, you're not doing this with your arm. You can paint, you can always paint like this.
Yeah.
Which saves you time than it would do if you did it for real. So, but yeah, always work bigger.
Because
you never know, like these things are for a magazine, but maybe at some point, you know, I could print it for an exhibition or something. I don't know, but
I'm surprised they didn't bring these out as like a giveaway poster, because they're so good. Know what I mean?
Thank you.
Yeah, so good. That one of Gregor, I could quite easily have that one as a poster on my wall. I can have the other one actually, but I like this one more.
Yeah, yeah, it's nice to see his face and.
Yeah, yeah. It is. It's brilliant. I want to get onto you if you've got time, Sam. I just want to get onto your other work, because you've got because on your website you've got like tons of work. When I was going over it, and I was like, wow, some of it is absolutely fantastic. So anyone watching on YouTube, head over to his website. I love the details when I pop it up. Let's just put that one down. Just that one. Close that one down. There we go.
Yeah, we just obviously just talk Star Wars till now, but that's really a small part of what I've done, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm going to bring up your website now. I'm going to put it to full screen because you said it is the better way. Now, if you go to samgilbeyillustrations.com, you can see all the work.
Just samgilbey.com or samgilbeyillustrates.com.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Samgilbeyillustrates.com. Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought, isn't that not what I said?
You said illustration, which I don't think would work. I should probably get that domain name just in case.
Yeah. Now, if you just scroll down, it all looks a lot. If I go into social, we'll start off with this one because there's so much here. It's just fantastic work.
Oh, thank you. I've ended up with so much stuff that I always advise other artists like coming up to say, get your portfolio down to like 10, 15 pieces.
Yeah.
But I got to a point where I've started to have categories because I've just done a lot of stuff and I don't know if people want to look at it.
Categories is the best way.
Yes, the best way.
Now, this one is the new one, the Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania. Was this one for Marvel's website, you know, for like an official painting that you can
So buy? This one and a few others, but this was, so I'm part of a collective / agency called the Poster Posse. Now, one of the other artists at Celebration, Chrissy Chung, she's also from the same group. Basically, it started out as a collective of fan artists doing this work for fun, you know, because, you know, they love to anyway, and putting the stuff up on social media, on their own websites. So unofficial work. Mm-hmm. And then I guess in fact, this year is the 10th year anniversary. I've been with them for about 6 or 7 years now. But basically, they started to get interest from the studios because this work was like getting retweeted a lot and stuff like that. So the studio started to commission artists. So basically the way it often works, and they've done different things, but it's like, say Marvel will commission 5 artists to do a piece that's going to be used on social media to promote the next movie that's coming out or show.
Yeah.
This is the most recent one I've done for Ant-Man.
I love it because you've got that image of like him. He's to Giant Man, you know what I mean?
That's
the shrinking process, you could see either backwards or forwards, but you got that pop, you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, I love that. I love the effect in it, in those movies. Because yeah, he does kind of, and maybe it's partly because I was a huge Transformers fan as a kid, and I used to pause the Betamax trying to work out how they did the transformations, like how they drew them. Except you'd have to press pause like 5 seconds before you wanted to pause it because it was so slow. But yeah, I've always loved, and I think with this, Marvel had said they wanted it to be quite trippy. They wanted to make the most of the kind of quantum realm stuff.
Yeah.
So I thought a way to play into that would be to just sort of try and illustrate that effect of him changing, because you know it's all about the changing of scale, and
it's great. I love the colours on it. Fantastic. I actually went to see this film because I sort of gave phase 5? I think I gave phase 4 kind of a miss because I think we're just going to end up on streaming. And I think I went to see Spider-Man, then I went to see Doctor Strange, and then I went to see this one.
Love and Thunder, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I missed that. I've still not seen it. You know, Ant-Man, I love the character Ant-Man.
Paul
Rudd is fantastic in it, you know what I mean?
So good. Well, the cool thing was for me was like, so my kids are 10 and 7, and this ended up being the first MCU movie they saw at the cinema.
Oh, yeah.
So they've been kind of catching up on some of the others, and I've shown them most of them as appropriate kind of thing. Skipped out a couple of bits and stuff, but they just love Ant-Man. They love Paul Rudd.
Yes, yes.
And again, he's, you know, he's good value in this one as well. I know it's had a mixed reception, but I really enjoyed it a lot. It does help if you're doing some artwork for something. Obviously, it does make you a bit more invested, maybe. Yeah. But yeah, anyway, and then Marvel, I mean, Marvel are amazing. So in terms of like, they will, and I think that they will like tag the artist on their posts, which is a great way, because, you know, it's any fellow artist will know it's really hard to kind of, with the way algorithms work, you know, the platforms are deliberately hiding your work from people unless you pay to promote it. So like this kind of support from, you know, like a dream client like that is priceless, really.
Fantastic.
It gets a lot more eyeballs on your work, you know.
Who would have thought when you was doing those early pictures that you would be actually doing Star Wars and Marvel?
I was finishing Andor for the show, for Celebration, and then I was kind of straight into this, or, you know, spinning the plates a bit on both. But yeah, like it's a total, you know, you still have deadlines to meet, and there's the reality of being a professional artist and hitting all of those things. But yeah, I never get tired of it, you know. Feel very lucky to be getting, I mean, I worked hard to get to wherever it is I've got to, kind of thing. And there's always other things you could do, but like, I'll never take it for granted, you know. If I never get to do it again, kind of thing, I still have got to do it, and I've, you know.
Okay.
Very pleased with that.
Brilliant. There's so much on your site, scrolling through, because I know time's kicking on.
Yeah,
is there any particular your favorites? Because I could go through this all day long of what you've done. Is this one showing you how you created it?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, so I did a course with Domestika, who specialize in kind of tutorials. They get teachers in to teach their process on various things. So I did one on basically painting portraits. So, you know, where I basically break down like a full process of my techniques. So, and when that course was launching, I just did an additional one that they could kind of use in their social media and stuff to kind of show what my course was about. But yeah, so, and again, it's the kind of thing I'm trying to get better at doing anyway, which is like, and it's in a way partly prompted by all the kind of artificial intelligence stuff we're seeing, where, you know, the computer's just outputting this stuff that's basically a soup of all these other images and all that stuff. But it's a bit, the frustration is like the onus is now on us as real artists who are actually painting to kind of show how we arrived at what we got to. But it's quite good to, so I'm getting better at like recording what I do, and it's actually quite interesting to then put it together and speed it up. And
yes,
because, you know, you can sort of see how you work, which you're not really thinking of it when you do it, you know.
Yeah. Do you know when you do those videos, Sam, is it like a special app or a cam? You got a camera on it, or I don't know how it's recorded, because I've got a friend next door who's a tattooist, and he often does these kind of videos and of, you know, him drawing and that. And I was thinking, how's he done that?
Cool. Yeah. Yeah. Well, QuickTime is great. You can just set QuickTime up to record your screen. But then if I want to do it off screen, then I've got like a GorillaPod little tripod smartphone on there, and then you can set it to be in time lapse mode on your video. So I guess there's various ways, but it's good. It's from time to time, it's good to do that.
You know, Cillian Murphy, that's great.
Cheekbones could kill.
Yeah. I like him. I've always liked him as an actor. I think he's been in so many good stuff. I want to see him in another 28 Days film. I really want to see him in another 28 Days film.
Well, or Star Wars.
Star Wars,
yeah.
Yes, and he was in the Tron sequel as well. And I was thinking, he's Dillinger's son, they've not made a third one without Armor. So that was really good. Iron Brew one.
Yeah, that was good fun.
It's like a Django Unchained.
They'd made a TV ad where no one could work out what it tasted like or something. Yeah, that's right. And so it was just like, looking at some of the classic Western posters from, like, I guess the 60s.
Yeah.
And sort of channeling that and just being... yeah, cheesy and over the top. And then yeah. one I did for a science fiction, a Sky show.
I've not heard of it.
Yeah, it's out there. It was again just really nice to, obviously things like Star Wars are the dream, but it's nice to sort of, I don't know, like in this case, like I had a really great photography reference, which isn't always the case.
Yeah.
Where they'd actually photograph the cast like outside of the show. Sometimes you've got like a HD, if you're lucky, copy of the show.
Yeah.
And then you're trying to take something from a screenshot. But in this case, I actually have proper character poses, which is what you need to do it properly. And then they made a video of that and stuff.
It's great. I'm just amazed at how good your faces are in these things. Like that one is a Daniel Craig Knives Out, of course.
Yeah. Brilliant. And then
it's all those characters' eyes. And you know who they are. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's great.
Well, that's a bit of a crazy one. So that one was done for an agency who are working with Prime Video. So I think the original Knives Out had come to Prime Video. So this was like a little social media thing. And it wasn't because of this, but if you go back a page, so I basically ended up working with Ryan Johnson last year on, if you go to the Dave Bautista, if you're into independent projects, that one.
I like this one.
So this was like crazy. Where I had to do, so basically Dave Bautista collects lunch boxes of like classic memorabilia, like Dukes of Hazzard, and then his character's Duke in Glass Onion. So basically I have Edgar Wright to thank for this, so I'd worked with Edgar a few years ago, and he basically thought of me when Ryan was asking if he knew anyone basically who could illustrate this lunchbox for Dave. And yeah, I did it. And then the props department kind of got the box and got the tin and got my artwork on there and stuff. And I got a nice comment from Dave saying how much he loved it and stuff. So like, you know, it's crazy. Like stuff like that. That's the kind of project, like you couldn't even dream to do it because it's such a weird, random thing.
It's fantastic. But again, yeah, I love
very
it.
It's a lot of fun.
I want it on one of those boxes. I think it's great. Absolutely great. This one here that you've done, I love this one. I would definitely have on a poster. The Companions app Kickstarter campaign forward
with the Companion app, if people have not seen that, it's an app dedicated to science fiction. So I'm sure obviously a lot of your listeners and viewers would be interested in that. But so when they were, they asked me to get involved, and when they were kind of getting it set up as a Kickstarter, trying to get people involved. So they were concentrating all on 90s science fiction. So they were like, how many can you do? And to be honest, I made it harder for myself because a bit like the Andor thing, like I was saying, like you want as few as characters as possible, as many as you need.
Yeah.
And when you start thinking about 90s sci-fi, it goes on and on. It gets bigger and bigger.
It is,
And it's like, well, if I have them, I've got to have them. And I mean, I could have also included Robocop, but I figured that, you know, 1989, isn't it? The original Robocop. Yeah. So obviously the sequels are in the 90s, but I just felt there was enough 90s stuff.
It's brilliant. You got Bill and Ted, you got the TARDIS, you got the N1, you got Michael J. Fox, the Terminator, Fox Molt, the X-Factor,
X-Files,
X-Files, that's it. The Men in Black. Mars Attacks, Universal Soldiers, Star Trek Next Generation, Alien, Galaxy Quest, my favorite. I love Galaxy Quest.
Oh, it's so great.
Mars Attacks, Super Troopers. Is this Super Troopers? Starship Troopers.
Yeah. And then right at the bottom, you've got Time Cop.
That's it. I was trying to look at that. I was thinking, what's that?
So I was big into Van Damme and stuff because I love like martial arts movies and I actually really like Time.
What's
Cop.
That though? What's the ball?
Oh, it's a Pokeball. It's a very low res. It's looking a bit low res there.
Of course, but, yeah, it's a Pokemon ball. Yeah, I didn't get it. I was thinking, is there a helmet, a red helmet? No,
in there is obviously live action apart from, well, you got Iron Giant as well, but yeah, Demolition Man and like Farscape and
Contact.
Ghost in the Shell.
Such a good film, The Contact. Ghost in the Shell. You got a little Fender.
Bender.
Yeah. There.
Just sitting on the Iron Giant. Yeah. So, it's so much fun. Obviously, something like this, again, takes ages, but, I love planning these out. And in this case, like, again, when you've got so many characters, you got to think of a way to make it all work. So using the vanishing point of like the Stargate, and then having everything kind of coming out from there is a way to tie it together.
Yeah. There's another one that I want to quickly go to. It was funny enough, it was your RoboCop one and an ET.
Oh, yeah. So that's in License Prince, which is near the top.
Oh, License Prince near the top.
Right, near the top.
Yeah. I think when I was chatting to you on Facebook Messenger, of course, Moon Knight, brilliant. There was your RoboCop, and I was like, God damn, that's good.
Well, thank you. So that was
just watching on YouTube. It's my page not loading.
It's loading in.
Yeah.
The RoboCop's down on that page, I think. So most of the things I've done in this kind of area are for limited edition prints.
Just leave that to load.
And then, the RoboCop one, which is in there somewhere when it loads, that's for a t-shirt that I did with Fright Rags.
Oh, which one?
The RoboCop one.
Oh, the RoboCop one. Okay.
But I think everything else, in fact, these are all limited edition prints.
Of Rockies, of the Rocky films. Yeah.
Yeah. All the Rockies.
This one. Yeah. We spoke about this one. This one, the Sonic the Hedgehog one. I love Sonic the Hedgehog. Absolutely. Yeah. I keep watching the films over again. It's one of my favorite franchises. And I love this one. And it's a little Easter egg for yourself that you're telling me about is the child's hands that hold the controller of your...
That's my son's, yeah. Sons. My son kind of representing me. It's the first time. Because, obviously... the way I work is I'm using reference, so I needed the kids' hands. I didn't have any pictures of me, but I managed to get, I went to CEX and got a controller, one of the old controllers, and got him to hold it. So it was nice to, and he's like an amazing gamer. Like he's far more skillful than I ever was.
Yeah, aren't they?
I cannot beat him at Mario Kart now. And for a year or two, I could, but now it's impossible. I think my reactions are getting slower and his are just speeding up. So,
yes, we're all been there. Sam, we've all been there. Here's that RoboCop one. Yeah, of course, this t-shirt. I didn't see that picture. Mm. I love this one. I love those where you've got like a logo and it's sort of like through the print. I've done one myself. But the colors on this one, because I'm a big fan of the colors.
Thank you. Yeah.
Retro.
Yeah. Like it's the kind of the retro grid kind of thing, which is obviously, it's kind of in the movie as like the screen technology and stuff. But like what I just saw with a t-shirt, it's interesting because you're trying to think of something that's like self-contained. It's more like making a badge or something. Whereas a print, obviously you're trying to get to the edges of a rectangle. But with a t-shirt, it's like, how can I frame it in a different way? And, I love the OCP logo. Anyway, that's such an iconic bit of graphic design. I just sort of had this moment of like, I just realized that the visor would just fit perfectly. So like his, the visor's like in that middle of the three kind of layers. And then his shoulder, his left shoulder on the right side, is like going perfectly with the diagonal of the top of the sea and leading you across. So just one of those things of like, you know, it's a simple, when you kind of, that's what, again, that's what I love. You just, you get that moment of like, oh yeah, those two things will work so well together. A bit like the, in the Andor piece, like the corridor and the sleeves and the doorway, you know.
I could have sworn, I had, because I went into my attic and I found a graphic book that I, because I'm not as skillful as you, as you know, when it comes to drawing, but I was very good at doing graphic art, you know, in the little squares, and I did similar of RoboCop, but you know, the one where he's getting, getting out the car, which that's what that shot looks like. I'm sure I've got it here somewhere. Because I took it out and I was looking through and I was thinking, bloody hell, they're pretty old.
That original poster for RoboCop, like, I never, at the time, I didn't realize that that is actually like an illustration. It's so brilliantly done.
Is that that original one?
Yeah, it's actually a brilliant, I can't remember his name, but it's a brilliant airbrush bit of work.
Yeah.
And airbrushing like, and with like obviously shiny things, like works really well.
Yeah.
But yeah, I love, yeah, anything shiny.
Here's a good question. Is this possible to still get this on a t-shirt?
I believe so. Yeah, I should have put the link in there, but yeah, if you frightrags.com and then search for RoboCop, and I believe, no, it depends, like I think some sizes have sold out, and you know, worth a look.
Oh, worth a look. I will. I'll check that out.
And I'm working with them again at the moment, so.
Oh, so you can say or so you can't?
I can't say.
Okay, no worries. you have got so much here, Sam. So much. Your Transformers one, great. Looks like the toys. I take it, did you have the toys there to go off?
Well, I do have toys. And, you know, for me, it was like the original animation was always like, the toys, you know, didn't do much, really. I mean, in terms of like the articulation when in robot form.
Yeah.
So the animation was what, as a kid, like that's what you were imagining all the time when you played with the toys. I just wanted to kind of capture that sense of like, yeah, it was like taking, because obviously the backgrounds in the show are painted. So it was just like taking that kind of approach to the characters that were just, you know, quick line drawings in the show, because obviously everything was just done in a crazy rush under intense pressure, I'm sure. But, you know, we still loved it and didn't see that, but, you know.
You're so damn talented, Sam.
Talented. Thank you. Hard work.
So many beautiful ones. This is another one that because I asked, have you done a Ghostbusters one? This one's brilliant, because I also run a Ghostbusters podcast. I love this one. This one's really good. They're here to save the world. It's that perfect shot, because when me and my wife, we watch Ghostbusters quite a lot. It's that look on Stay Puft Marshmallow's man's face of when the Ghostbusters blast him, like it hurts. It was like,
and it looks so evil at that point. Yeah, as a kid, that really this is the movie, one of the first I saw at the cinema, and absolutely terrified me. Like, I loved it, but also had nightmares for 3 weeks, you know. But yeah, and it's partly, it's like Stay Puft, like when he does that expression, it just seems like pure evil, like he's hurt. But there's something about it. Oh, it's just so good. But yeah, this was, you know, like, as you've seen, like, where possible, I like to paint portraits. Like, that's what I feel I like to do the most. Yeah. But also my stuff is kind of observational. As long as I've got some sort of reference. And sometimes when you do a licensed print, you know, you're told at the get-go, you can't use the faces. But with something like Ghostbusters, I wasn't going to let that stop me. I still really wanted to do a Ghostbusters print, you know, because that's like, a childhood dream.
Yeah.
And obviously, I could do Stay, you know, the point was I can do Stay Puft's likeness. So you just kind of make the most of that, even if you can't do Bill Murray and everyone else. But yeah, man, I never want to see another backpack, because they took so long. Because like each one is like painted separately.
I've got a massive one there. Look at that.
I should have. If I'd have known you then, I would have asked you for like some photo reference. Because like going through the movie frame by frame, trying to get slightly different angle and stuff.
Oh, God. I've got a real a real Ghostbusters one on my wall as well. I want to just point out on this, I don't know if you've done it deliberately, but where there's you got Winston, his proton pack, the red light is there on the first first. Then you've got Ray's, it's on the next one across.
Yeah.
Then Beckman's, Bill Murray's character, is the next one down, and of course the last one of the sequences, Harold Ramis. Was a character Spengler is there. Did you do that deliberate? You know, one, two,
three. It's kind of crazy thing. I'm glad you noticed that kind of thing, because it's the sort of thing that you figure no one will notice it. But when you're doing like drawing these backpacks over and over in detail, it's almost like anything you can do to make them different, you know, is like something that you can then just felt. And again, watching the footage over and over, trying to find stuff, you realize that those lights are going off all differently. Why not bring that in? And it just it's a little detail, but
great. What piece, what was this made for? Was this just you just did it off off the fly, or was it for some marketing, or was it for like for a book?
So all of the stuff here was like released as a poster, well, apart from Robocop as a t-shirt, but yeah, these are all done as limited edition prints. So this one was I've worked a lot with different companies, but I did quite a few with a company called Fanatic. I did Jaws, Jurassic Park, ET with them, but those prints were often released through Zavvi, where they would do a timed edition where the print was available for a few days, and then the Ghostbusters one I worked directly with Zavvi. So again, it was like I think it was like an edition of like 200 or something, and they had it up on the store, and then as the artist you kind of get a bit of a fee for that, and then you get normally like 10%, so I kind of got 20 copies. I might have a couple left actually of those, so that's typically how it works basically.
So this one you can't get now,
like I don't know if Zavvi have any left, and I might have a few, so I'll need to do a stock check, but if you know, if you want to talk.
I was going to say the other thing as well. If you could actually buy them from you, like from your website, then I could probably do a cross link to my Ghostbusters one for some, because I know some quite a few Ghostbusters that are probably like this one.
Again, I should have told you about this one at the time if I'd known. But no, thank you. Like so, at the moment, like what I used to do is I used to have my store open all the time, which was nice, but then that meant like orders came in on kind of ad hoc basis. So I found that I was sort of going to the post office like more and more often, like a few times a week. And that was nice that people wanted things, but it was also taking away from time I needed to make more things.
Yes.
And my wife helps me as well. It's like, she's great. She'll help me pack orders and things and do various bits and pieces. But I found now that it's better. What I do is I open it a few times a year. So I'll open my store for like a week or two. Then I deal with all those orders over that time, and it's just a more focused way to do it. So it's like, then I do that and then I go back to making more things. So I'm hoping, so obviously got Star Wars Celebration coming up, that's like the next thing I'm focused on, but I'm hoping like as soon as I can after that I'll get my store open again, and some of these prints are sold out, but some of them I do have a few copies left. Spider-Verse is gone.
But, I like that one, especially now the sequel is coming, so
so excited for that thing. Hopefully
Onwards, fantastic. David Bowie, Batman, Mask of the Phantasm. I tell you what, these look like they're on the DVD covers, these ones. Your Jaws one was fantastic. I've seen that in the wild. I'm sure I've seen that one in the wild somewhere.
That's definitely been in like HMV and stuff, so that would probably be the most likely place you might have come across it.
It's just there. It's just there. But my PC has not caught up with it yet. But the ET one is one of my favorites as well. My PC has not caught up with it yet. Oh, there we go. So there's your Jaws one. Love the perspective on this one.
Thank you. I mean, I won't take credit for the perspective, like, because like making a poster is like, so sometimes it's like a scene and it's trying to reimagine a scene, or like a collage of characters or whatever. In this case, like there's a panning shot, you know, where Quint is first of all looking at Hooper, and then he turns and looks at Brody, and but that's landscape, right? And then I just realized, oh, I could like merge that into one, so you see the whole ship. Yeah. But if I make it, and there's something about making that ship vertical that then gives it this kind of almost like, it's almost like vertigo, like,
yeah,
it really gives you that sense of like the perspective. Yeah. And then the way it comes together is like, so the playing cards are in a diagonal line.
Yes.
And then then Quint, if you look at it, it's his jacket strap on the shoulder is like also in that kind of angle. And then that leads you up to the far top corner where you have the shark, you know, just in the corner. Yeah. So and yeah. Obviously it's a bit of it's trying to have the characters look away enough as if they hadn't seen the shark. Right. And having that, you know, but yeah, thank you. Like that was sort of like one of those moments of like, I saw because I initially I was disappointed because I was hoping I had planned out a whole thing with their faces.
Yes.
And then I couldn't do that. And I was actually really disappointed. And I was like, again, it's like, but I really want to do a Jaws poster.
Mm.
So, and you know, the fact is maybe, or no, probably definitely, I ended up with something better because I couldn't show their faces.
Mm. Nailed it, mate. Especially with, I love the shark, how you can see the silhouette of it underneath the water.
Yeah, just.
Just like the film, how the shark didn't really work, so they could only show bits.
Exactly, it's the not seeing it that's the power, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, and this one, this E.T. one is beautiful. Absolutely. Oh, thanks, I love this one because E.T., you know, back in the day, I've never cried so much in my life in the cinema. But this one is great. You got his bike, you got E.T., you got the speaking spell, you got even a deer in the background, and of course you got the mothership coming in, and it looks just like the movie, the same atmospheric look as it comes through the trees.
Oh, thanks. Gosh. Yeah, I mean, it's always, yeah, it's trying to like, I think what I've always been trying to do, I guess since I was a kid, is like, I'm trying to take the excitement that I feel watching these things and it's trying to channel it into an image. And, you know, that's the goal. And sometimes it works, I guess sometimes it works less well, but that's what you're going for. And it's about getting, like, I remember in this case, like the bike, I think I had a 3D model of a BMX that I started with to position it. And then trying to draw that crate took so long.
Yes.
And then I've got stuff like this. So there's like, there's Reese's pieces in the undergrowth and
just there. Yeah.
Just there. And then one of the things, like, I don't know. So I've got E.T. glowing from behind because I figured, like, and I've been through the whole film, you never see him from the back when he's glowing. So it's artistic license. But I figure with how bright he glows from the front, I figure you must be able to see the glow at the back.
Hold on. Are you sure that, because no, when the ship takes off and flies off, you see him in the corner sort of looking up, and don't you see him from the back glowing?
Oh God, maybe I missed the frame.
I always took
at the time, I remember looking for ages, and maybe I missed one.
I'm like yourself. I, in my head, I might be lying to myself here, but in my head, I thought the glow was all the way through him.
Yeah, you know what I mean, I figure part, so physics, it must be. But anyway,
because if he's beating half on one side, surely you'd be able to see it from the other.
Yeah, that's fine. But yeah, such a beautiful film, and I sort of did another version of this because in that, there's like a sunset version as well, because we think of the blue as being, because all the marketing, like Drew Struzan's posters had that kind of deep blue in it. In the shot in the movie, it's like it literally goes from the sunset. I think it's like they must have been shooting it and they ran out of light, so it goes from sunset one shot to like kind of like this royal blue, like immediately after.
Gets really dark real fast.
Yeah, you can sort of argue that it worked as either a sunset one or this blue one, but the blue here goes best with the pink.
It's absolutely fantastic. Right, what we're going to do, Sam, because we've been chatting for a long time.
Yeah, it's been a while, hasn't it?
Is there anything? Yeah, it is. Is there anything on this that you want me to point out? Because there's so much stuff. Your Jurassic Park stuff, brilliant. Stranger Things, my kids love Stranger Things. Scarface. Hmm. There's just so much on your website. You know, film packaging as well. You know what I mean? So these are like DVD cases or something?
Yeah, yeah. So I've been lucky enough to do The Karate Kid, which was, you know, as an 80s kid, that was, you know, massive for me to get to do that.
Yeah.
Like the trilogy box set, especially with Cobra Kai kind of having this, you know, resurgence for everything of that kind of world. Yeah, so I've done lots of, quite a few. Blu-ray cases and things for special
True Romance. Yeah,
So I've worked with people like Sony for the Karate Kid and Arrow Video, so more kind of cult things.
Yeah,
I mean, True Romance is obviously, you know, I guess a mainstream movie, but it wasn't a big hit at the time, you know.
Yeah, I like that film. Spider-Man,
Far From Home.
I wonder if I've got any of these myself. I haven't got Far From Home myself. That is great. That is.
Are cool. Like, if you when you're doing a steel book and you're working out how it's going to wrap around from front to back, and
yeah.
So yeah, I mean, you know, there's nothing in particular. Like, if people want to see more, there's certainly plenty to see.
I'm just thinking, I bought I don't know if you've done it. I'll probably find it here. Because I bought the steel one to Ghostbusters Afterlife steelbook, and it had like this picture of the Ecto-1, and it looked like a drawing to me.
No, it is. And it's by, I feel so bad if I'm going to forget his name off the top of my head. He's a great artist, and he had just done that piece as a bit of fan art, and then Sony picked it up. Yeah.
Oh, that's Train to Busan.
Yeah. Yeah, so I did Train to Busan. Oh, it's so good. It's really good.
Because I was thinking about picking that one up. I'm sure I looked at that one and I was thinking about picking it up because I like that film.
It's a great movie. And there's also like an animated, so this is like, there's like a trilogy because Peninsula was a sequel. And then there's also like an animated one called Soul Station.
Is that?
Which is like a short, so that's packaged with the Train to Busan movie.
Because I've not seen the sequel.
It's very different. Like, it's worth a watch. I mean, I definitely don't feel it's as good, but it's it's still pretty intense, you know. But there's something about the, you know, it's the being on the train, a bit like The Raid from a martial arts perspective, where it's like that, it's that trapped location is what.
Yeah. So many. Oh, look at that. I love that. Just going on to your magazines ones with your original print and your baby Yoda. Fantastic. Yeah. Absolutely fantastic. Yeah. So, do you know, I've got him myself. Just there. That's my Mando helmet there. Yeah.
Beautiful.
I've got the small ones as well. It's been absolutely fantastic.
I can't find this artist. I feel really bad.
I've got it.
Drop me something for the notes later. But
yeah.
Oh, thank you. Thanks a lot for reaching out and talking about all the stuff I've done, which it's weird. Like, you sort of forget about things you've done. And then you look back and you're trying to give people some of the, you know, I guess the standout things. And then you realize there's quite a few of them. So, you know, I'm very lucky to have done what I've done. And, I'm not going to lie. It's living the dream to be able to do stuff for Star Wars and Marvel and things I grew up with as a kid, like Ghostbusters.
Yeah. I tell you what, you are... Yeah, fantastic. Your artwork is brilliant. Just go through your website, because spend all day long going along. And you know, definitely when your store is up, if you send me a link, I'll repost it.
Thank you.
We'll try and get some more love for your artwork.
I appreciate it.
Because, you know, I try and encourage people, you know, if you love this artwork, please, please, please go over and show Sam some love. Go and buy his art. Go and buy his artwork at Star Wars Celebrations. Get it signed. Then rush over and get it signed again by Luna. You know, try and get them done. It all goes into to highlight how much artists should be appreciated, because they work bloody hard. You know, I mean, you really do bring, you know, work hard, you know, with Jason,
well,
and the rest of you work really hard to produce such quality artwork.
Yeah. Well, we're super, well, I can't speak for anyone else, but, you know, generally speaking, as artists, like, you appreciate the lovely conversations you have with people at comic cons. Mm-hmm. And obviously sales, a nice conversation and a sale is even better. But like in the case of like the Star Wars show, you know, we originally were submitting work back in November, and then kind of finishing it at the beginning of this year. We won't kind of make anything, you know, we won't get anything from the show until like after the show's over and all that stuff. So it's like a long, you know, it's a long kind of stasis period where you really put your love into something. But the fact is, for us to keep doing what we're doing, you know, all those sales really do help, because that they let you carve out the time for the next thing. You know, so that's it.
And bearing in mind that you can't enjoy the rest of Star Wars Celebrations because you're sitting at your booth signing. You know what I mean? That's the bummer of it. You know what I mean?
Because
like you said, you know, it's the first time it's back in the UK, you know, so we've got a chance of having it on home soil. So you want to get out of there and have a look, but we'll do appreciate it, Sam, for what you do.
Oh, well, no. I think, for me, you know, you're kind of aware that you're missing out on cool stuff that's happening, but equally that's going to happen when you go anyway, because you can't see everything all at once. So, you know, to quote the award-winning film, but like, I think you just, the atmosphere is so great, you know, all of these events. So you're kind of like soaking that up. So you get the adrenaline from that buzz that everyone else has. And like, you're there to work, as it were. But, you know, you're surrounded by like-minded people and fans and stuff. So, and it's great to meet them, you know, so can't wait, really.
Cool. Now, Sam, where can our viewers sort of pre-order your, because there's still time to pre-order your artwork if they need to pick it up, can't they?
No, that's closed, actually. So I think the pre-orders ended on the 20th. So there were like 10 days for the 10th to the 20th.
Yes. Yeah.
So that's closed. So that it's true that we don't get any copies to sell after the show. So if you do like the Andor piece, or, you know, again, check out, you can still look at all the other art at darkinkart.com, from all the other, you know, amazing artists, check it all out. But then the only way to get it now is to come and see us at the show.
And buy one from yourself.
Yeah. And to buy one from us. Yeah.
Cool. Where can the viewers also get in contact with you?
Well, probably social media, the most active is Instagram. So it's at Sam Gilbey there, which is G-I-L-B-E-Y. And then I'm the same on Twitter. And then Facebook is Sam Gilbey Illustrates. I've also got, if anyone's like wants to sort of show some extra behind the scenes stuff on a can, I've got a Facebook group, like a private Facebook group, which is, I'll tell you what, on my Instagram, there is a link to my link tree. And on my link tree, I have everything on there, including the private Facebook group. So if you start there and then find me all over the place, basically.
Oh, I'll have to have a look at that myself.
Until you get sick of it all.
Great. So, yeah, it's been absolutely fantastic having you on this show, Sam. And I look forward to seeing you at Star Wars Celebrations when I nip by the artist tables and have a gander at all the impressive art. That's for sure.
Absolutely. So, no, well, thank you for the support. And, man, looking forward to meet you for real. Very soon now.
And we'll have to go for some beers. We'll have to go for some beers.
Sounds good. I'm going to need one.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Thanks again, Sam. for coming on.
Right.
Radio Free Endor. Cheers. We'll see you soon. Don't go. Cheers. Don't go yet. Yeah. Oh, so okay. Thanks a lot for coming on Radio Free Endor. Brilliant.